So this afternoon's session was originally entitled the Prebrim Session, meant to honor Carl Prebrim. And one of the speakers originally was Dr. Walter Freeman, and I'm sure that you've heard by now that unfortunately Dr. Freeman passed away just a few days ago. So this session will really now honor both the work of Dr. Prebrim and Dr. Freeman. Our first speaker will be Dr. Anthony Huditz. Dr. Huditz has a background in biophysics. Then he turned to the cerebrovascular system, the foundations of neuroimaging, and since then has really been a pioneer in applying the principles of consciousness science to the field of anesthesiology and anesthetic-induced unconsciousness. He is currently professor of anesthesiology and neuroscience at the University of Michigan Medical School. He is the director of laboratory science in the Department of Anesthesiology and also the scientific director of the Center for Consciousness Science at the University of Michigan. So please join me in welcoming him as he talks about brain dynamics and anesthesia.
Thank you, Dr. Mashour. I greatly appreciate being here, speaking in this symposium, standing here on podium here in Tucson for the first time is somewhat humbling, but it's very exciting at the same time. So you already heard that my talk will be about anesthesia and brain dynamics. Since this session is about dynamics, let me start with a movie. What you're seeing here is fluctuations in fMRI, the so-called blood oxygen level dependent signal that is derived from fMRI in a human subject in a resting state when subject doesn't need to do anything, it's just lying there. And what you see there, the color code, shows a spontaneous formation of various configurations of activity in the brain, red being high activity and blue, of course, low activity. And these spontaneous configurations change periodically, somewhat non-random way, and really form the basis of what I call dynamics. Our question really is, how does the dynamics change upon loss and return of consciousness as modulated by anesthetic agents? So before I get to the data, let me just flesh out the common or main ideas here. So about dynamics. We think about a stream of conscious experience as one that consists of an uninterrupted sequence of dynamically changing brain states. The other concept is the repertoire by which we think about the richness of conscious experience, that it depends on the diversity, or if you like, repertoire of distinct states that the brain accesses over time. Integration and complexity are measures of intrinsic information associated with neural interactions, and it's assumed that these quantities are reach their highest value in the conscious state, might be reduced in anesthesia. And if time allows, I'd like to say a few words about criticality. It's something Dr. Freeman was also very interested in, which expresses the idea that the brain operates near instability in order to maximize its information capacity and its state repertoire. So just a couple of hypotheses related to anesthesia now. So we would propose that anesthetics disrupt the spatiotemporal dynamics in the brain, diminish the brain's repertoire of states that you have seen in a movie, and therefore impede information integration in the sense of Tononi or other. Anesthetic-induced changes in dynamics, we think, occur at multiple spatiotemporal scales that spread from microscopic to mesoscopic to macroscopic, and these may be, in fact, interlinked through scale-free properties of the brain. And finally, we also postulate, not so much a hypothesis, a technical issue, that the examination of dose-dependent effects of anesthetic are important in identifying the critical neuronal mechanism that are associated with the transition between conscious and unconscious state. So let me first mention a couple of ideas about this. My time is only allowed for mentioning three main interesting ideas. So one of the questions, what are we expecting to find? We're measuring neural activity by various methodologies. How does that relate to the conscious state? So one possibility is the level or state of consciousness depends on neural activity in a very general sense, neural properties, events, in a particular way. For example, it could be a very graded transition, as it shows by the blue curve, which will be consistent with the IIT of Tononi, for example. So the consciousness is a graded function of some neuronal property. But it also could be that the transition between conscious and unconscious states is a very abrupt one, perhaps a phase transition such as Steyn-Ross and others and many others suggested. And the main question here is, what do we expect to find? Do we expect to find a continuous relationship or an abrupt one? And one could argue that if the transition between consciousness and unconsciousness is in fact a binary or abrupt, it will be much easier to find a related neuronal event that occurs then and only then when conscious transition occurs. Another thought to mention is the hysteresis. It is possible that during removal of consciousness, which is the red curve, different neural activities would be present in a general sense from when we restore consciousness, and that's the blue curve. And so the two would form a hysteresis, which has been called neural inertia by Max Keltz and colleagues at University of Pennsylvania, indicating that in some sense, higher neural energies might be required to restore consciousness from those threshold phenomena that we observe at loss of consciousness. So there, it suggests that one needs to look at these phenomena, both increasing and decreasing conscious anesthetic levels. And the final thought before getting to my data, I'd like to mention this, that I've been working with Thalys Bachmann recently, that we believe that the level or state of consciousness and its contents are intertwined in the sense that when anesthetics act, they affect the level of consciousness as well as the contents at the same time. And this necessitates a multidimensional assessment of the conscious state, not relying on a simple index, but desirably using a multimodal assessment. Just on the lower right, you see a sensory testing battery that we use in animals, for example, in rats. So one of the very first neuroscientific ideas goes back to actually Walter Friedman, Singer, Koch, Eroy John, and many others, is the gamma oscillations. And I just want to very briefly mention that. Here I'm showing an example of the effect of isoflurane, a gas anesthetic, on gamma oscillations. And the top is a 0% awake animal. This is a rat. In which in EEG is measured in a frontal cortex, can see very beautiful 40 to 45 hertz gamma oscillations ongoing. And as the anesthetic is increased by about 0.8%, which is loss of consciousness, you begin to see slow waves, and these gamma oscillations became entrained into the slow waves. And Dr. Bouzaki has done very interesting work, of course, pioneering work in this too. But what I'd like to say is that this type of gamma activity, although entrained, it remains present even under anesthesia. On the other hand, the very high frequency gamma oscillations seem to be more interesting. On the top, you see a time frequency diagram, time frequency power diagram of gamma, and between the 70 hertz and 140 hertz in particular, the highly intermittent gamma activity is seen. And on the lower part of the figure, you can see how this activity is changed. If we take a band-limited power analysis of the gamma and delineate the high gamma states, which are the little boxes drawn around the trace, those are the high gamma and in between the low gamma states, it can be seen that at about 0.8% isoflurane, which is where the rest lose their writing reflex and other behavioral indices of consciousness, these gamma activities start to be highly fragmented, and the gaps between the activities become longer and longer. So in a sense, the activity falls apart in a temporal domain. So now we can go a little deeper And this was at a sort of large-scale level. And we're going to look at more deeply into the vein, looking at spikes, which are, we call them spike. They are essentially extracellularly recorded action potential. So neuronal firings. In this particular experiment, we use microelectrode arrays, such as the one you see on the top, which is a 64 contact microelectrode array on 8 shanks. Each shank has 8 contacts. So in a matrix form, these contacts are spaced about 200 microns apart, so they don't have much crosstalk. So this array is, in this example, implanted in a visual cortex, primary visual cortex that spans, the array spans the entire cortex from the top of the brain to all the way to the bottom of gray matter. And we do that at different anesthetic levels. We usually start at a high dose and then go toward wakefulness. And what I want to show you here is the dynamics of firing. So you see the color scale, sorry, I don't have it there, but blue to red is increasing firing rate. This is something that derived from every channel, so the matrix is actually reflecting the recording context, the arrangement that you see on the top. So there's pretty high firing rate and fairly random looking. Don't be deceived, though. And let me show you the unconscious pattern, which is obtained with another inhalational anesthetics, in this case called desflurane, very similar to isoflurane, it's more better known. But basically, neural activity also reaches very high peaks. However, even visually, it's very apparent that the activity is broken up, again, fragmented in time. So there are large gaps in the activity that develop. So that's interesting, but what does it really mean? So does it mean that it's something to do with the neural, how the neurons communicate and talk to each other? We think it does. So this kind of data we can resolve into bursts of activity by the fact, by the advantage of that, that the interspike interval distribution is bimodal, so on the top you see some examples, and so there's a minimum between the bimodal peaks that can be used as a threshold to separate gamma, high spiking and low spiking periods that we call up states and down state. And on the right you see a correlation map of the 8x8 in the 8x8 arrangement of the neurons, but really focus on the lower left where we show that the correlation, the average correlation among neurons is reduced as the anesthetic is increased from 0 to 6% in particular, which is just beyond loss of consciousness. So what happens in the system, the neurons start to fail to be correlated. Now, does the correlation mean they actually stop talking to each other? That's more important for us. So there is another method. It's called the cross-correlogram method. Which was perfected in Dr. Bujaki's laboratory, actually, and we were glad to adopt this method to map monosynaptic connections in this electrode array in a visual cortex. And you can see an example here on the left in a gray area, panel D. On the left, the blue arrows indicate excitatory monosynaptic connections, and the red ones are inhibitory connections. And this is in the awake animal, and to the right of that at 6% desflurane, I hope it's readable, is what happens when animals lose consciousness. So much fewer connections, but basically still some are present. So what do we get when we put all the data together? What we see in the upper right diagram, that the primary effect of increasing the anesthetic level from wakefulness to loss of consciousness, 0 to 6, is a reduction of excitatory interactions. So one neuron exciting the other, but the inhibitory connections stay unchanged. And this is somewhat surprising to neuroscientists who are familiar with the fact that in vitro anesthetics, in particular this anesthetic, desflurane, is thought to be primarily augmenting inhibitory connections. This is coming from patch clamp studies and in vitro direct channel studies. However, in the intact system, in vivo, things play out a little bit differently, apparently. So this is interesting, and besides, it's telling us that the change in correlation patterns were indeed due to an active interaction in neurons. Now, we like to get closer to the information aspect because we believe that all these culminate in the question of information integration in a sense, do anesthetics alter the intrinsic information in the cortex in particular or elsewhere in the brain? So here we look at that directly. So we're taking this multineuronal spike train, which is shown on the top. It's just an example from 10 neurons. Every little mark is a time point of firing. And below that is a schema how we digitize this. So we assign a 1 to when a spike is present and a 0 when a spike is not present. And we do this in 1 millisecond increments. Then you can see that different simultaneous or coincident spiking patterns arise. And for example, the pattern C, it repeats 3 times here in the sequence, in pattern E, 2 times. And one can find all the recurring patterns and the differing recurring patterns. And from the enumeration of the statistics of the simultaneous spike patterns, one can calculate the total correlation within the neural network, or another measure that we call, it comes from Tononi actually, interaction complexity, that similarly describes the information content associated with the interaction of the neurons. The two quantities have slightly different meaning, which I'm not going to go into, but on broad scale, they yield similar results. So here are the results. We do the experiment actually without stimulation and with stimulation, sensory stimulation, that is in this case, because we're recording the visual cortex, therefore we're using a light stimulus, a light flash in the left eye, or alternatively through the skull directly stimulating the retina. So it's a full field stimulation. And we look at these information quantities before and after, so pre-stimulus and post-stimulus. And you can see the result, blue is pre-stimulus and red is post-stimulus. So three important conclusions from this figure. So one is that flash stimulation in the eye, sensory stimulation, increases a large amount the amount of information embedded in neural interactions. So red curve is higher than blue curve. Second, that in all cases there is a dose dependence relationship between these quantities as well as the anesthetic, in this case desflurane, as you can see. So 0 is awake, 8 is already very deep anesthesia. And third, and probably most important, that in the zone where consciousness recovers, here we're going, is lost, between 4% and 6%, the steepest change in these quantities occurs in this zone. So in particular on the left, you see integration, you see the curve coming up quite fast. But equally important, even more importantly, if we focus on complexity, that's the diagram on the right, the post-stimulus, so sensory-stimulated cortex, which is the red curve, plateaus out in those conditions when the reds are conscious, according to our behavioral measure. So 0, 2, and 4, at that concentration, reds still respond to stimuli. But then immediately, complexity starts to fall off as we increase the anesthetic further. So as I said in the beginning, this is an important finding from the point of view that we're looking for some kind of threshold phenomenon at which where consciousness is altered in a rapid manner or as a threshold manner as a function of neural activity or modulation of desflurane. And I believe that this is a good example for that. We can also increase the complexity and neural interactions by stimulating the ascending arousal system. This is an example from electrical stimulation of pons, increases the visual cortex as well as parietal association cortex. Complexity and neural interactions, look at the dark on the left. The dark blue bar is significantly elevated. And we can also augment the effect of sensory stimulation by stimulating the ascending arousal system, which really brings the cortex up to a higher activity level. And that you can see actually by the difference, in the difference between the light, the light, the green bar here relative to the preceding gray bar. So these are important because they are telling us that what we're measuring by these quantities is actually meaningful, and it's representing some meaningful quantity of information in the cerebral cortex. And finally, from this, the very same data or related data, we also tested what happens when we induce anesthesia and remove anesthesia, induction and emergence. And so consciousness, LOC, loss of consciousness between 4 and 6%, and regain of consciousness between 6 and 4% left to right. And so we see that, in fact, these changes are reversible on one hand, but also the figure is suggestive that somewhat higher complexities occur post-anesthesia, which may have a number of explanations that will remain to be elucidated in the future. And now I like to go back to mesoscopic dining. So these were single spikes. Sometimes it's hard to find spikes at every recording site, but we can measure local field potentials a lot. This is something that Dr. Freeman was also very interested in, and he based much of his work on local field potential work in a rabbit, in multi-channel electrode arrays. Now we do that in rats. So here's an example of changes of spiking and local field potential, which is just, it's the same signal but filtered to a lower, LFP is filtered to a lower frequency band. But it represents population activity, and that's very well seen here, in particular in anesthesia. If you go down to the fourth line, it's labeled unconscious, 6% desflurane, it's very clear that the spikes in, from two neurons in this example are associated with the negative, the downgoing peaks of the local field potential. And this has been, of course, very well known in most preparations. What this is adding, perhaps, to the knowledge that this kind of correlation exists throughout the entire range of anesthetic depths. And therefore, and as it's shown by the cross-correlation diagram on the upper right, as well as below, and therefore, it can be a useful measure to track neuronal population activity across the entire spectrum from awake to deep anesthesia. So we do just that, and so we use the same electrode array. In fact, it's the same recording, but now we're looking at local field potentials and actually quantifying the negative peaks. When a negative peak exceeds a certain threshold, we call it a binary on event. And let me show you the dynamics. So here on the left is the conscious dynamics of these negative peaks exceeding thresholds. So the dark spots are whenever LFP, the population activity is high. And it's immediately clear that this activity clusters in different regions of the recording field. And they tend to conglomerate, these activities tend to form clusters or contiguous patterns of activity, which is interesting on its own. Why is that happening? And in the unconscious state, for comparison, which is 6% desflurane again, we see similar patterns. But again, like we saw with the spikes in direct recording, let me just restart it so you have a view on both. These contiguous activation patterns that we call them, or CAPs for sure, for short, they occur widely spaced out in time. So then again, this activity seems to be very fragmented. There are, on the lower diagrams show this, of course, at anesthesia, 6%, there are many, much fewer events, and the gaps between these LFP events or NLFP, negative LFP events, NLFPs for short, are also much longer in anesthesia, 6%, than in awake. Okay, so that's great. We already guessed this from the spike recording. Now the question is, what are these patterns like? And do the patterns carry some significance for information processing? Are they, first of all, are they different between anesthetic states, the patterns themselves, disregarding their temporal variance? So what we did is we started to classify the patterns, and we used the statistical method known as k-means clustering, essentially dividing up based on the similarity of these NLFP parents, dividing them up into, in this case, 12 different most prevailing forms. And so these are actually data from 6 animals, each row is another animal, and then these parents are ordered in descending order from left to right, the most frequently occurring on the left and up. So these are the forms that we see. Now the question is, are these different in anesthesia? So when we look at that and do the clustering in different cluster numbers, we can classify them 12, 24, 48, 96, as many you wish, we find that in all anesthetics, the very same cluster patterns occur, which is interesting. That's not what I expected based on the repertoire idea, then the repertoire shrink. However, at the very same time, the proportionality of the different activity patterns is changing. So on the right side, you see a summary of 12 different patterns at different anesthetic levels. Let's just focus on the green bars on the top, which is in the awake. It's different, quite different in cluster one from the little bars below it, but they become more equalized in other clusters. So what does this mean? It means that although principally the brain, the cerebral cortex goes to the same spatial patterns of activity in wakefulness and anesthesia, some of these patterns become much less frequent and become ignored. So certain brain states are beginning to fall out of favor. And now I'd like to go to another level, and this is macroscopic dynamics, and I started with this fMRI data from the human. And that data analysis is ongoing, but we have a complete data set from rats. So let me show the same dynamics now from rats. So this is again blood oxygen level dependent signal, spontaneously occurring. Left is the nose of the rat, and on the left is the back, so the front of the brain to the back of the brain, top of the brain is a sagittal section. And let me start it again. And you can see again the same thing, that certain region, the periodic formation of dynamic clusters, red is high activity, and of course blue is low activity. And then our task is to quantify this in different anesthetic states. So we do that. In this case, because the animal is in a scanner, we don't go to drug-free condition, but we start with a very low drug level, which produces conscious sedation. It's just enough to relax the animal so he can stay motionless in the MRI scanner, and that's a 20 milligram kilogram per hour dose. And in here case, we use an intravenous anesthetic propofol. And then we do the same experiment, a higher dose of 40 milligram, which undoubtedly causes unconsciousness as it's shown, the diagram shows, using our behavioral testing battery as well as the EEG pattern. So we're looking at a conscious sedated to an unconscious animal. And quantifying, and here's some snapshots from the previous movie. From the top, you see actually a couple of randomly selected configurations. And below is a quantification of the patterns. And for this, we use a so-called regional homogeneity index, which is nothing else, nothing more complicated than a local correlation of activity. So it delineates certain brain regions that are simultaneously active. So you can see these red patches here on the bottom that, or regions that are that form simultaneous activity patterns. So we're going to quantify these. And there are different ways to do this. Most impressively, if you look at the top diagram, you can see the size of these correlated activities, bold activities, undergo fairly large fluctuations. On the top, the red curve shows the fluctuation in size of these patterns. And then below, at high dose, the unconscious state, these fluctuations are largely reduced. And a quantification of this is that reflects the repertoire or the diversity of brain state can be done with the temporal variance, simply looking at the temporal variance of this time course. And we see that this temporal variance that reflects the repertoire is significantly and robustly reduced in the unconscious state. And for that matter, please look at the lower right diagram. The yellow is the conscious and the red is the unconscious. So the brain loses, at the large scale, a very large amount of its activity patterns. And we can, from the same data, now most recently in collaboration with Dr. Tononi, we did this, extract information-based measures. So here we use the Lamp-Osiph complexity, which is a measure of complexity, the shortest code that you can code a binary sequence with. Without going too much detail, it's been published. In any case, on the top row is the same six animals in a binary representation of their bold activity, and below is the conscious, unconscious state corresponding animals. And you can see at the very bottom, the statistical analysis shows that it is very significant and uniform reduction in complexity of these bold patterns in the red brain in the unconscious relative to the conscious state. I'd like to continue, just go back to the human brain a little bit. So here we use a computer simulation to get at the dynamics. And the motivation for this was to build something that physicists call the Ising model with long-range connections, which is more commonly called the spin glass model, which basically takes simulates the condition where that different brain regions, very small brain regions, probabilistically interact to develop certain spatial patterns in time. So we call them upstates and downstates. It's just a nomenclature. But basically, the interaction patterns are based on fMRI data. So here's an example. It's actually an average of 20 subjects, and it's their functional connectivity pattern that we derive from bold data, and we set up the interactions of small regions based on this connectivity. And then, this is what we see. So on the left, the simulated brain activity is the dark red. You can call it upstate, and blue is downstate, if you like. The ongoing interactions create large-scale forms in this brain. This is now on a flattened brain surface in the left hemisphere. And you can see how now in the posterior half of the brain, a large cluster form, now it's moved to the frontal cortex and so on. And this goes on dynamically for a long time. Now we simulate the effect of anesthesia, computer simulation, by reducing the cortical arousal level, which is equivalent to actually reducing noise in the system. And those who are familiar with the Ising or spin glass model would associate this with the temperature variable. And it's the same simulation indeed, with the difference that now this simulation is based on actually measured data. So here you see what happens in anesthesia, simulated anesthesia, that again we have large scale forms however these forms are locked in. They're frozen and they have a very time moving on to another form. So therefore what you would say the repertoire again is tremendously shrunk. It's minimized compared to the metastable states that you see in the awake. Okay, so these are the various patterns actually that form. This is what I call the top 40, the 40 most frequent forms that we see spontaneously forming under normal conditions. And then here I summarize the results from the different conditions, and most importantly, the arousal level that, as I said, it's the temperature in the Ising model T. If we look at the number or the dispersion of various brain states, so these global forms, it's a certain index that can be used to quantify. We call it a dispersion index, the cross-correlation coefficient divided by the variance of the cross-correlation coefficients. In any way, this parameter has an extremal behavior, dependence on the activation, cortical activation level, such that on the very peak, you have the maximum number of different brain states, maximum diversity or repertoire. And if the cortical activation is reduced in a model, such as presumably occurs in anesthesia, then we have much less states. Or if we increase the activation level, that would be something like happens in seizure, then again we have. So it suggests the brain in this case is at the, or the hypothesis rather, the brain sits at the critical state and it maximizes its repertoire. The last question I'm going to address is, does this really happen in vivo, not only in silico? Now, it's a difficult question because here we stimulated 100,000 states. It's very hard to collect fMRI data or any kind of data that long, perhaps more at a smaller scale with spike recordings and the like. You can get a lot more data, but fMRI, we limit it to usually 1 second, 1 second, 2 second sampling. That is not going to give us enough data. But there's another way to get at that. So this kind of criticality called self-organized criticality, and again, a question Dr. Freeman, I know, was very interested in early on, can be inferred many cases from the parallel distribution of certain statistical descriptors of our system. So parallel can suggest the presence of self-organized criticality. It doesn't prove it, but it at least gives a possibility for that. So our question was, so if there are there parallels, and how do they change under anesthesia? So here we see a couple of results. On the top, we took the data from the local field potential recordings, and if you look, on the left is the anesthetized, on the right is the awake. The parallel is shown on a log-log plot of the data. If it's linear in a log-log plot, then it's a parallel. And the slope is minus 1.5. That's been traditionally suggested to indicate criticality, various authors. So you see the data in blue dots, and the fit to that, the linear fit in red, and that is a beautiful parallel right there. And then a parallel is, as we allow the animal to wake up, is slowly changing, but it's more or less maintained. The same finding is from the rat bold fMRI data below. You see conscious and unconscious, they both parallel, and the slope doesn't change. And on here on the top, my slide before last, is human data. Here we see that these subjects were volunteers were anesthetized with propofol. Wakeful baseline, parallel, deep sedation, same parallel, and after recovery. Another analysis from another set of subjects, now we have 26 of them, I'm showing only three. Here we use the so-called avalanche analysis on the brain surface that I showed you a movie of, and you can see in four conditions, wakefulness, light sedation, deep sedation, recovery, the parallel is there beautifully, the slope is minus 1.5, suggesting criticality, but they all maintained in all conditions. So what does this mean? It may be that, yes, the brain is in a critical state, but perhaps it's not something removed by anesthesia, which in some sense is great because we want anesthesia to be reversible. So brain maintains certain functionalities. And of course, this is just a possibility. Certainly more work needs to be done. So I know I'm over time. I'm just going to conclude, summarize the findings. So what we found really here is anesthetics interfere with spatiotemporal dynamics of spontaneous ongoing and stimulus-related activity. Anesthetics also disrupt neuronal interactions in local circuits as well as large-scale circuits of the brain. Anesthetics will fragment the temporal continuity of local neuronal activity, and they reduce the dynamic repertoire of at least the large-scale network state. And these effects diminish the information capacity, as we saw in the spike data, and the integrative ability of the brain, presumably. And finally, the power law distributions are unchanged in anesthesia, therefore, this criticality may not be exclusive to the conscious state, but please stay tuned, madam. More to be followed. I thank all the collaborators and advisors and colleagues who were with me on this journey, and in particular, Jeanette Wizet, Sivesh Pillay, and Charlene Shippinglu did most of the animal work I showed. Charlene Lu, Colin Humphries, and Catherine Lauer, the human work, bulk of the human work. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tony. It's my great pleasure to now introduce Dr. Gyorgy Bouzhaki. Dr. Bouzhaki is the Biggs Professor of Neuroscience at New York University, and he is a preeminent neuroscientist with international renown in the field of information processing and neuronal oscillations. He's the author of over 300 scientific publications, a number of books, including one you might have seen called Rhythms in the Brain. And just to give you a sense of the caliber of Dr. Boujaki's scholarship, I was just reviewing his papers. And in the past month, he's published articles in Neuron, Nature Neuroscience, Nature Medicine, and Science, which many of us would be happy with across our whole career. So with that, please join me in welcoming Professor Boujaki.
Thank you very much. When Dr. Mashour and Dr. Hamarov invited me to this meeting, I wondered what kind of title I would give and what aspect of our work would talk about. I'm working in, mostly in rodents, but I know this is a very high-level conference, so I gave this title. And I'd like to take you through a journey which will show you how we can gain information from inside the brain and start our work going from inside to outside and see how we can build up a function or brain function in a different way than most people in our field do. Most of you, what you do is you take a signal from the outside world and you see what impact that signal has on the brain. And then you, from here, you would like to see how the short components or the early components or late components and others, how they change when the animal perceives or when human perceives, and eventually when it becomes consciousness. Our strategy is the other way around. We take the brain as an independent variable and we go from inside out. So the topic that I'm talking about, emergence of cognition, is complex enough without even mentioning awareness and more complex things. But nevertheless, it doesn't mean that we shouldn't start speculating about it. So here is a speculation. Simple brains, this is a hypothetical little brain here, that has some function. Every brain has a variety of different functions. Perhaps the most important thing of all brains is to predict the future. The reason why brains can predict the future is because we live in an environment which has recurrences, regularities, and algorithms in the brain can take advantage of this and predict what happens next. Now, in this very simple organism, and I can't find my pointer here. In this very simple organism, what happens is that it generates an output. Once it generates an output, with the output it moves the cursors, it makes an ideal situation for the cursor, it registers the consequence of the action, and if the consequence of the action is positive, it does one thing, if it's negative, it does another thing. Now, next time the same event occurs, or the same kind of environmental constellations occur, then animal knows better how to respond. So you notice what I did is I started with an output, and I showed what the animal does, which is basically a hypothesis testing, and I said, I'm going from there, from my action. I'm examining the consequences of my action. So it's not a perceptual action cycle, it's an action perceptual cycle. So this is, of course, very simple. This hypothetical organism, which could be a fly, it could be an ant, it could be a C. elegans, can predict the future, but in a very simple environment and at a very short time scale. Now, let's see. Okay, there we go, that's fine enough. Okay. So what happens over the course of evolution is that we add complications to this input-output structure pair. We add a loop here, we add another loop, and another loop, and another loop, and we keep going on until we have many, many loops, like in the human brain. Now, the entire reason for all this complication is nothing else, just to predict the future better. Now, you can look at it, or you can view these loops here as a result of evolution, or as a result of your own experience in your lifetime. And he said there are lots of interactions between the loops, but all they do is to predict the future now in a much more complex environment in a much longer time scale. We go to college in order to predict our future 4 years later. Now, this is very good, this is very nice, very effective, but it is not cognition yet. What requires to to talk about cognition is the following step. These loops with individual training get very smart, and at some point the loops, the algorithms become so smart that they have no longer need to rely on the environment or on the body. This is the process I call disengagement. At this point, the brain can disengage from the environment, or in other words, it internalizes the learned knowledge into the brain. This is the point when the brain can start to look into its own computation and see what happens or what would happen if I would act this way or I would act that way. So in the rest of my talk, what I'd like to do is to show you three examples. So let me start with the first and simple example. Every mother knows that baby kicks are very important. These baby kicks emerge about the third trimester of pregnancy. They are important, every gynecologist can tell you, because they correlate with a variety of different things, such as the healthiness of the child, as well as 20 years later with your IQ. But we have no clue what these very simple behaviors actually provide to the brain. Well, the good thing is that the same kind of patterns also occur in rodents. When rodents are born, they correspond to about the transition between the second and third trimester of human pregnancy. And what you can see is what they do is kick. So what we wanted to understand is what happens in the brain at this time. To tell you the truth, this is not exactly the question we asked. The question we asked was, what is the first organized pattern in the mammalian brain? So we started recording from newborn animals, and every day we went on and started looking at the brain and see what happens. And what happens when you record from a newborn rat, in this case it's a two-day-old animal, is that for a long time there is nothing. Tens of seconds there is absolutely nothing. But all of a sudden there's a huge activity here. If I zoom in, then what I see is a very nice organized oscillation. It is a rhythm. And Dr. Mashour or Dr. Hudetz and many of you in the audience would say, wow, this exactly looks like a sleep spindle. And in fact, the morphology and many of the physiological bases for this are like sleep spindles, except that they occur not during sleep. And there are other interesting things about it. So if they are not occurring during sleep, how they are initiated, and they are initiated rarely. And you may already suggest or predict from my previous slides is that they are caused, they are initiated by kicks. So time zero here is whenever a kick occurred, and I'm showing here the firing of action potentials, that is the firing of the neurons, after the kick, and you can see they go very high for a long time. And if I look at the power of the local field potentials that Dr. Hudetz talked about, you can see this could be quantified here with a color, and there's a beautiful relationship between cause and effect, in which case the cause is the peripheral kick. And if we map the neocortex in the somatosensory area, we will find that the maps are different depending on whether the kick occurs in the forelimb, or hind limb, the tail, or somewhere else. So these patterns are mosaic-like, which is fundamentally different from what you see in your brain as an adult, because these sleep spindles are like these up and down states that occur both during anesthesia and during sleep. They are pretty homogeneous and simultaneous across the neocortex. And the reason why they are mosaic-like, because at this stage of development, the brain is mostly vertically organized. What it means is that the afferents from the spinal cord go to the thalamus, they, from the second stage, they go to the third stage, the neocortex, and that's about it. The communication goes up and down, and not so much down, but up, but laterally, that is across the cortex, there is very little communication. The long range connections that arise from layer 2, layer 3, are not there in place yet because the brain is immature. Also, the subcortical neuromodulators such as acetylcholine, norepinephrine, serotonin, and so on, they are not there yet at this early age. So I told you one thing, that all these events in the brain are caused by a peripheral action. And it's a random effect. It's due to nothing else but the stochastic pattern of the ventral horn neurons in the spinal cord, or even simpler, just the stochastic release of acetylcholine onto individual muscles. So sometimes you see that one single muscle is moving alone. Sometimes your hand is moving, and other times you've got a whole body startle reaction, as you have seen in the movies, both in the human baby as well as in the rat. So now we can speculate why is it useful? Why is this important teaching pattern? And I don't have time to go through all the details, but imagine the following. We have about 650 muscles in our body. We can put all these muscles on the table here, and they are still connected to this developing brain. And they start twitching. And what this pattern provides to the brain is exactly nothing. However, in the body, in the living animal, these muscles are anchored to the skeleton. And the result of this is their degree of freedom is constrained tremendously. Those muscles that in the future will perform similarly, these are called agonists, and the antagonist muscles that are competing with them will be activated together. And their representations in the brain will be activated together in time. So by the time the long-range connections from various parts of the neocortex grow in, then they will have a timing rule that allows them to wire things together. In short, these spindles, these early spindles, serve a very important role, is nothing else just informing the brain about the shape of your body. The brain has no a priori information whether it looks like a ball, or it looks like a snake, or it likes the way you look. In fact, there is more than that, because in a growing baby, the distance between the index finger and the nose, if the baby would like to scratch the nose, is changing daily, because the organism is growing. So it has to be updated every single day. And this is the mechanism how it can do that. Now, the interesting thing, and the reason why I'm telling you all these stories, is that, of course, something must happen over time, because I introduced my story with this, is that they look like sleep spindles. So by the end of the week, the long-range connections come in, subcortical neurotransmitters are there, and all of a sudden, these spindles, the occurrence of the spindles, are not relying anymore. They don't have to rely anymore on any trigger from the body or from the environment. The pattern becomes internalized, and they occur only during sleep. This is why they become, or they will be called, sleep spindles. So this is a first example that I'd like to show you, that I wanted to show you, that initially a brain pattern depends completely on a trigger, a Newtonian cause from the outside environment, but eventually it gets disengaged from the triggering activities, and the pattern becomes internalized. Now, this is just a repetition and showing that indeed this is the case, in not only in animals, but also in premature babies. So this is the way how the brain gets informed about your body size and body shape and so on. But the spindle and the relationship between the spindle and the kick never disappears completely. Tonight, when you go home and you will go into your bed and you fall asleep, you will see that sometimes you will have a big reaction and you almost fall out of bed. If you would allow me to record from your EEG, I guarantee you that there will be a spindle. So the initial stages that we went through while we were developing come back in short segment in light sleep when sleep spindles are present. So in other words, it's a very interesting thing to this audience, I assume, is because it shows that the brain has to be informed about whether we live in one body, if we live in two bodies, whether our consciousness, our unity, belongs to one type of experience and another type of experience. To prove this, I thought for a long time, what we would need is, of course, to provide or deprive the brain from its possibility to act. Not from sense, but from act. That is, in a hypothetical brain, where there is a lot of information that can come into the brain, but the brain cannot do a thing. My conclusion is that their brain will not be conscious, that brain will not learn anything, that brain will not feel or learn anything about the body. Unfortunately, that's a difficult experiment, and again, unfortunately, many of these difficult experiments are produced by real life. So here is an example.
Tatiana and Krista Hogan are what's called craniopagus twin cochrane.
The brain has the problem of dealing with two bodies.
They have connections amongst blood vessels, both arteries and veins, but they also have this connection between their what's called the thalamus and between the thalami, one in each.
They are very interconnected. they share a lot of things normal conjoined twins don't. They have the special abilities.
These twins, of course, live every moment of their life together.
See what
they interacted all the time together.
Look at all that hair.
During this haircut, for example, watch Krista. Is she seeing through her sister's eyes?
Look at all this hair.
You think they do share?
Oh, I definitely do. I definitely do.
Felicia holds a pencil where Tatiana can't see it and asks her to grab it.
One in mommy's hand.
And watch closely here at Tatiana on the left while Felicia strokes Krista's arm.
You know, when you were rubbing her arm gently, she started smiling. And she had an expression like she could feel it.
Yeah.
So the astonishing thing here is that we have two fused brains, let's say one and a half brains. It has to be calibrated by two separate bodies. They learn about each other's bodies very intimately, yet at the same time, they are two different entities. They know who they are, and you remembered what the movie said or what was represented here. When Christina was asked, what happens? That you touched Tatiana's hand. So there is a complete knowledge about the boundaries between different parts of the body, even though the brain is fused. So the real reason why I showed you this, as I mentioned, is to show you indeed that there is such a thing as disengagement from the environment at this particular level. My next two examples will come from my favorite areas called spatial navigation. The Nobel Prize was given to, just 2 years ago for discovering of grid cells and discovering of place cells. But these cells will be not very useful without the first set of neurons called head direction cells. So let me explain briefly what they mean. If you come to New York or to an unknown city, what you do is you take the subway and you come out and you have a map in your hand. And you would like to use that map effectively. The first thing you have to do is to orient that map, and you have to figure out which one is north and south. If you don't do it, which is essential, you will end up like me. Sometimes I come out from the subway and I walk 5 blocks north and I realize I'm going in the wrong direction. So the first thing is the head orientation of the map. The second thing is to see the relationships of the things, the buildings in the world, and in the map usually have squares and not equilateral triangles like in the brain. And the third thing, very important thing, is to place yourself on the map. Now, the interesting thing, of course, is that without these neurons, without the head direction, the rest of the game is useless, therefore they are important. Where are these head direction cells? They are in the brainstem, in these so-called mammillary bodies, in the anterior thalamic nucleus, the postsubiculum, the parasubiculum, entorhinal cortex, striatum, lateral septum. In other words, they are everywhere. There are many, many places, which tells us if things are represented in many parts of the brain, this thing is very important. Now, let me explain what they do. So if I'm looking at this loudspeaker, there is a set of cells in the system that I just mentioned that's higher at a very high rate while as long as I'm looking at the loudspeaker. And I turn my head around at every degree, there will be a set of neurons will keep my head direction very effectively. So my brain knows the sense of my direction. In order to show this, of course, we have to record these neurons from small animals, such as mice and rats, and our specialty is instead of putting in wires that are damaging the brain quite a bit, we use these silicon chips. And then from these, the help of the silicon chips, we can identify the action potentials and the local field potentials and so on, the same way as Dr. Hudas was talking to you about. So here is an example of a set of head direction cells. So this is recorded from the anterior dorsal nucleus, and this is from the posterior nucleus. And you can see that each of these are very nicely tuned. Now, the reason why I picked this particular sense, that is our sense of direction, is because this is the easiest, this is the most simple possible sense that we have. Vision is very complicated. It has all sorts of dimensions, such as color, orientation, selectivity, intensity, and so on. Same applies to all other things. In this system, the head direction system, every neuron cares about nothing else except one-dimensionally where your head is looking at. So why are these neurons fire? Of course, there is you take the textbooks, and the answer is that they are caused to fire. They are caused to fire by environmental inputs, such as vision. But it turns out when you blindfold the animal, it doesn't disappear. The cells are still there. Then you can say, oh, it's probably the vestibular system. And you do with the vestibular system, you destroy the vestibular system. It's not this, nothing really happens, nothing serious happens to the head direction system. Then you can cut the head muscle or the neck muscles, and you can do a lot of very interesting things until eventually you do 5, 6, 7 manipulations before you see a very severe deterioration. So the answer is that the information is largely coming from the world. It's again Newtonian neuroscience, that the activity in the brain is caused by something. So this is the thing that we would like to test. And in fact, the test is very simple. If the idea is that it's the vestibular system, it is the vision, or it's the neck muscles, all we have to do is to wait until the animal falls asleep. When the animal falls asleep, the vestibular activity is constant, vision is absent, all the other sensory stimuli are at minimum. So we would like to know what happens. And this is what happens. What you see here is a group of neurons. These ticks correspond to actual potentials of one neuron, another neuron, another neuron, and the other neuron. And then we have small LEDs on the head of the mouse. And with that, with the help of these two LEDs, we can tell exactly which direction the animal is looking. Now, the next step, we can use this set of neurons and try to predict which direction the animal is looking at. And you can see the prediction is pretty okay. The black and the red line are almost identical. So from a handful of head direction neurons, you can have a precise idea which direction the animal is looking at. And the neuron why they fire here is because they are probably caused by environmental input. Now let's see what happens during sleep, which was just actually prior the animal woke up from sleep. And to make the long story short, we can tell precisely which direction the animal is looking at while in REM sleep. Because the activity is still organized. It's pretty much the same way how it happens during waking state. And you can see that even during slow wave sleep, the firing rates of the neurons didn't change at all. They are pretty much the same as before and after. And here, the organization is not so simple to see because they are faster. So the activity is pretty much the same now, but the activity shift is about 10 times faster during slow wave sleep compared to REM and the waking state. So let me explain it in a little bit better now. Let's take two neurons. Let's say a neuron that looks, when I'm looking at the loudspeaker, is firing. Another one which is just a few degrees off. Of course, when I'm looking at the loudspeaker, these two neurons happen to represent the same space. Therefore, they happen together in time also. We find a positive correlation. And when one neuron represents the loudspeaker, the other one is 180 degrees something over there, then these two neurons don't overlap in space, don't overlap in time. They have a negative correlation. And if there is positive correlation, negative correlation, there must be something in between, which is no correlation or no reliable correlation. So the interesting thing here is this cell pair has a positive correlation during waking, positive correlation during slow wave sleep, and also REM sleep. And this one has negative, negative, negative. The big difference is that you can see from the scale bar here is that during slow wave sleep, it is 10 times faster. But nevertheless, the rule is the following. 30 degrees representation precedes 40 degrees. 40 degrees representation precedes 50 degrees, and so on. And this rule does not change independent of the brain state. Well, that's very interesting, because it suggests that it's not quite true that the organization, or the reason why the different neurons fire in different sequences, is because the environment is causing them to fire. Something else must be added to it. The brain must incorporate this knowledge one way or another in order to use it more effectively next time when it turns the head. And what is shown down here is that all of these pairs are compressed into the line, so these are many, many, many pairs, and you can see the minority of them are positively correlated, two-thirds of them are negatively correlated, and there is a nice shift here at about 60 degrees. Now we can do what we really wanted to do, is to see to what extent is this organization internalized, that is not reliably, doesn't have to rely on the environmental cues, and how much it is internally organized. And the answer is the following. What we do here is we take a bunch of neurons from the thalamus nucleus, and we are trying to predict the timing and the firing rate of individual neurons in its target area, which is the posterior subiculum. And you can do this trick from a short time window, a long time window, from many neurons within the same neuron, within the same brain region or multiple brain regions and so on. It doesn't really matter, and you can do it in three different states, such as slow wave activity, REM sleep, or waking. And on the ordinate here, you see the bit value of information about the spikes. And the bottom line is this. Waking is better, no question. On the other hand, if you look at it, two-thirds of the information is derived internally. Only one-third is given to you by your senses. So why is it good? Well, it is good because it allows you to interpolate. It allows you to extrapolate. You can blink, you can close your eyes, you can even twist your head and turn it back to the original position, and you don't lose. Interpolation and extrapolation, of course, need a very complicated circuitry, and this is what happened to be here. So this is my second example, how a system that initially completely depends on the external environment, now it becomes internalized. Now let's go to the place cell systems. Place cells are named place cells because a neuron in the hippocampus likes to fire at one particular XY coordinate of the environment, let's say here. But when the animal moves from here to the end of the podium, different sets of neurons will be active along the way. And you can see here, this is the place field of neuron 1, neuron 2, neuron 3, and so on. And the argument is that the reason why these neurons are sequential is because the environmental cues from the world or from the idiotic cues from the bodies are causing them to fire sequentially. But if that was the whole story here, I wouldn't be able to stand in front of you and tell you about our research, because what I'm doing here is I'm not relying on any of the questions, I'm not relying even on the slides, everything comes from within. And the reason why it can be done is because there is an assembly of neurons that were activated, then Dr. Mashour introduced me, and then that group called up another neuronal group, and that called up another assembly, another assembly, another assembly, and these assembly sequences in the hippocampus can go on forever. So this system that is worked out nicely for spatial navigation can be used for something else after internalization, namely giving this talk. So there is another way of thinking about this, namely that the sequences can be internally organized as well. So if you read the animal literature, what you usually get is that, the hippocampus and its company does nothing else really but helps us in navigation. And that's good. There are two types of navigation. One is called dead reckoning type of navigation, which is exploration of the environment. This is something we actively do. Once we explore the environment, we go to every part of the environment, we can make a map. And once we have a map, we can use that map more effectively. In fact, every animal is using a map if landmarks are available. But if there are no landmarks, we have to go back to our idiothetic kind of information. It is something like that, that when you go to a city that you have known and you know where the church is or where the Empire State Building is, it's easier to drive around. But if it's a foggy day, then you have to rely on things like, did I make a right turn, left turn, how many right turns did I do, and you keep track of your own positions. So it's clear that in order to generate a map, you need to generate first, or you have to explore the world. So you go from here to here, but once you generated this, you have a map, you can give it to anybody. Anybody who can read the map, then it's benefits from it. It's called allocentric information. Now, the interesting thing about memory is that it also comes in two flavors. One is what we call episodic memory. That is the memory that we have. These are our own experiences. These are the things that what makes us who we are. Now, if you have seen a dog, or this is a nice scene about your one of the first important experiences, you will never forget when and under what condition it happened. But after seeing another dog, and another dog, and another dog, and many kisses and so on, then these interactions and intersections occur in multiple ways, then you stripped down the spatio-temporal conditions, and those things become facts and names, such as this is a microphone, this is a laptop, this is a glass of water, and so on. And they become semantic knowledge. The same exact way how it happens during spatial navigation. So this is the take-home message from this slide. Nature first works out a method to allow a set of neurons or the set of structures to work together and work effectively in the navigating the environment, including shortcuts and detours and other things you need for navigation. Later on, or with more complications, what happens is that these patterns become internalized. Now what you can do with that is to do a mental navigation. With mental navigation, you can go back to the past. This is called recall of your experience. This is memory. Or you can move forward into the future, which is planning. In other words, it is not by accident that this system that initially relied on external cues can incorporate knowledge from the world, can make those predictions without any help from the environment. And this is another example of incorporating information from the world. I have to skip this. It's very interesting. This is the structure of the hippocampus, and it shows how many neurons and how many the different connections are there to interact with this. But I have a very short time left. So what I'd like to do first is to show you 40 years of very hard work compressed into one simple slide here. And this field has been worked on by the best people in this business. What you hear, or what you just heard, is that this neuron is a single action potential, fires whenever the animal is here in this corner, and that corresponds to a place field here. And of course, this neuron is not alone, there are many of them. This is a pair of neurons, but you can see there is a red and a green one. We can measure the representation of green and red. We can measure it with a ruler, how far they are from each other. But interestingly, what you see in the other side is that these neurons relate to each other not only in this real time scale, but also within the tens of millisecond time scale that corresponds to brain rhythms called hippocampal theta oscillation. And we can make a measurement from here. We can make a measurement from here. So this is a ruler-based measurement in the real world. This is a temporal measurement in the brain. You can correlate them, and then you can see there is a nice relationship between time and distance. And I have multiple slides, or many, many slides, to explain that indeed the primary thing the brain has to deal with is timing. The brain has time constraints. The information doesn't travel at the speed of light in the brain, but it's confined or constrained by the speed of propagation of the action potential in the axons. Therefore, it doesn't really matter whether you are dealing with a small brain or large brain. Time is of the essence. You can scale a brain from small to large, 17,000-fold increase, yet all the brain rhythms that are present in the tree shrew or in the mouse or rat are the exact same with the same frequency, give or take a few percent, in a large animal, including us. So what is the proof for my speculation that I just shared with you? Namely, that there is this system that relies on the environment, and the same system allows you to travel mentally. Now, the reason why we can do this experiment, because we rely on a very good theory, which is the theory of O'Keefe, who introduced the term of play cells, and it's predictions. Good theories predict. Unless a theory can predict something, it's not very useful. So the theory predicts is the following. If by imagination we freeze a rat or rodent or any other animal here and now in space and time, but maintain this dynamic, what we call hippocampal theta oscillation, some neurons in the hippocampus should fire forever as long as the animal is here. Other neurons which do not fire should be silent forever. So the way how we examine this is in this apparatus that you can see. The task here for the animal is that just explore the world, go to the right, and you will find water here. And next time, instead of going to the same position, go to the other side because water will be there. If you go back to the same side, there will be no water. This is called the spontaneous alteration behavior, which is quite natural to rats, and it depends on the hippocampus. The trick that we introduced here is that between the choices, we ask the animal, please run always in the same direction. That is, face always that screen, and run pretty much the same speed. So in our power, we have done everything that the information that impinges upon the sensors from the world are constant, and the information from the body that impinges on the brain are constant as well. So what we are looking for to test the hypothesis, or verify or reject, is neurons that would fire continuously as long as the animal is running, because it's not going anywhere. In fact, what you will find is quite the opposite. Here's a neuron that, on every single trial, likes to fire, now this is not distance, but time, at about 2 seconds while the animal is in the wheel. This neuron is a little bit later, this neuron is a little bit later, and if you have enough neurons, then the entire journey is covered by some neurons. So, of course, this is very useful. This is nothing else but an activity packet is traveling in this n-dimensional space of the hippocampus, and it may be meaningful for something. And we think this is meaningful for predicting the future based on the experience from the past. Where did I come from? Where am I heading? So what we can do now is separate these sequences or this trajectory into two, depending on the outcome of the behavior, whether the animal will go to the right or whether the animal will go to the left. So let's examine one neuron now. This is just one neuron. You can see the action potentials are there. A series of action potentials occurred. The animal goes to the left. Complete silence in this case, and this is a very nice neuron. Nothing really, you can detect anything. The animal goes to the right, and then goes back. Spiking, you can already predict that in the next trial, the animal will go to the left. And this is a good game. We can look at the correct trials and incorrect trials. So this is a good neuron. However, this is completely useless to guide behavior. The reason why it is useless is because decision here should be made 20 seconds earlier, and this, or 15 seconds later, and this neuron fired only for 1 second. So now the interesting thing is that when you have a large number of neurons, then in this case, this is our neuron that I just showed you, there is another neuron and another neuron that segregates the information based on the past into the future, depending on internally generated patterns that are shown here. And if you record from large number of these and you separate them, this is one neuron, two neurons, second neuron, and so on, and the identities are the same here, the difference between this panel and this panel, that is the left choice and this is the right choice. And I don't have to convince anybody in this room that it can take a slice of time anywhere here, any narrow time, you can make a very nice prediction, effectively, which direction the animal will turn 15 seconds later, 15 seconds later, including errors, with 90% accuracy. That is, from these recordings, we can record and predict the future 15 seconds ahead. So those of you who are interested in free will can think about this. So what I can do here now is to go back to the hypothesis. Said, oh, where are they? Where do they come from? Where are these sequences coming from? And the answer is that if the hippocampus has no clue about the world, it just has one initial state, one initial condition, it can't help, it generates sequences, and then we are talking about memory or planning. However, if this memory, my recall, my lecture would be interrupted by questions, then the environment would direct and change this trajectory so it would jump from one direction to another direction in just 100 milliseconds or one single theta cycle. In other words, the hippocampus can do sequences in two fundamentally different ways, internally and with the help of external cues, but nevertheless, we can reject the idea that it's only one way to do that. So this was my second example, my third example, where I showed you that initially we were relying completely on external cues, but the brain is capable of disengaging from the environment, incorporating the information, and then internalize that learning information to serve something that is pretty useful. So I go to the summary slide here. Back to my first one, it said, initially, there is a simple brain that can predict the future in a simple environment for a short period of time. We add a lot of complications to this simple brain by adding a lot of loops, a lot of hardware, a lot of algorithm learning, and they do things better, predict the future at a longer scale in a more complex environment. But the interesting thing happens when the brain can internalize the learned information. It can disengage from the world, and this is the point when we can talk about emergence of cognition. This is the time when we can check, and the brain can examine what-if scenarios, that is, what would happen if I do that, what would happen if I would do the opposite, without actually moving our muscles, and I think we all agree this is what we call cognition. And the final slide is just remembering our good friend, Walter. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that fascinating lecture. I'd now like to welcome Dr. Karen Shaner to the podium. Dr. Shaner is a professor of neuroscience and psychology at Georgetown University. She's also a practicing clinical neuropsychologist in the Washington, D.C. area. And she was a student of Dr. Priebram at Stanford. She worked with him professionally for many years. She also worked with Dr. Freeman, and it was Dr. Freeman's wish that Karen represent him today. So please, Dr. Karen Shaner.
Carl is with us. Those are Carl Priebram's brain waves. And by the way, thank you very much. I appreciate being here and having had the opportunity to be very close and teach with Carl for 15 years, Carl Priebram, and then also to work closely with Dr. Freeman. Carl's 90th birthday, we showed the brainwave, the EEG mapping of his brainwaves that he took in 1994 when he was about 75 years old. As you can see, he found there that, in fact, the brain changes up to 200 times a second. Not only that, he found that we do have individual patterns. You might call them brain prints. But most of all, I wanted you to know that Carl is here with us. And he found that, in fact, for many of these EEGs, that even in resting position, there's a lot of action going on. Now, we're going to talk. No. Where's the clicker? Excuse me, just a minute. This is a different paradigm. So I go from here. All right, we are now switching from action potentials, wires, telephone wires, as Carl referred to them, to waves, Wi-Fi, cell phone information. And both Carl and, thank you, both Carl and Walter were very much in the paradigm of waves and fields. Waves of the future and the past. And when I show you later on, what I'm going to do, I talk about the shoulders of giants. I can only do so much in 30 minutes, but I am going to follow what Walter asked me to do, and that is basically to talk with you about some of the main concepts, of Carl's and of Walter's, but especially Carl's, and then we will end with, I will show you and share with you what Walter was excited about, that in fact, in his research, he verified the holographic aspect of the brain and was very excited to share this with Carl. Now, Walter said, because you have the review of that he wrote of Carl's book, The Form Within, you should have a copy of that. And also, you can read his abstract and the wonderful description of his life. And we are very sad to have lost Walter. At the same time, he was very definitive in terms of how he wanted this presented. And I feel so very privileged to have spent a lot of time and work with both men. And Walter and I were in the process of writing a book on his latest work, which in fact includes now also the whole quantum area, as you heard Henry Stapp allude to today, the neurophil, and the work that he has been doing with Giuseppe Vitaello, I should know how to pronounce that, but anyway, on the quantum area, and especially the double. All of this will be printed soon, and you will have a chance to see it soon in Harold Achenbacher's Mind and Matter journal. And that was the last bit of work that, in fact, Walter has published, and he's very proud of it. So I want to tell you all of this that you look toward, because right now I'm just going to share some concepts with you. Now, before I move on, waves of the future and the past. Everywhere and every when, as Carl used to say when he talked about the hologram. And I will show you that. Now, Carl really and Walter loved coming here. And this is Carl at the conference in 2008, having a wonderful time. And now, June 2014, I had a chance. Walter and his wife Doe came and stayed with me in Washington, D.C., and I found then that Walter actually was raised in Washington, D.C., and his home was about a mile away from where I live. I drove them to see Carl in Warrenton, Virginia, Northern Virginia, and here is Walter and Carl, and Carl is, this is June 2014, Carl is signing his book for Walter. This is at Carl's house in Warrenton. Now, waves, wavelets, and fields. To remind you, the brain is an electric organ, and the brain is a pattern detector. And nerve energy, as Walter likes to remind us, and if, as you read his review of Carl's books and a lot of other of Mass Action, Walter's books, he talks about the 19th century that Hermann Helmholtz, the thermodynamic model, end of century biophysicist, showed that nerve energy is not conserved and can't be measured. Well, what are we talking about nerve energy? And then beginning, but we're talking about waves and fields. And we're also talking about conservation. By the way, I'll give you a clue. The brain is an open system. And that's why, as you learn about the double that Giuseppe and Walter have been working on, you will see how the brain interacts with the thermodynamics and the energy of the environment in order to process information, in order to process perception. But in the 1950s, mainstream engineers and systems analysts replaced nerve energy with information, and they created a new paradigm of neural pulses. And textbooks of neurophysiology in that era, and continue, because I teach cognition, state that action potential were the sole means of communication between neurons in the brain, and half of the electrical activity, and that they discarded half of the electric activity of the brain. They kept the wires. This is very simplistic, but just to give you a concept that the action potentials are like telephone wires, neuron to neuron, and the connectivity that is there very specifically and in a material form. Meanwhile, you have the Wi-Fi going on that has been set aside for a long time and both Carl and Walter focused on. Carl loved this. It's Sherrington's The Brain is a Pattern Detector. He said, an enchanted loom where millions of flashing shuttles weave a dissolving pattern, always a meaningful pattern, though never an abiding one. And by the way, Carl had one of Sherrington's operation tables, if you will, and was very proud of that. It has been put in the museum now. So how did Carl Priebram, who is a neurosurgeon at the University of Chicago, and was trained very in the 40s, how did he get to appreciate brain waves and the Wi-Fi, if you will? Well, Ralph Gerard at the University of Chicago, Carl always remembers how his professor demonstrated to those of him in his lab that if you make a cut in the brain cortex that did not, even though the nerves were severed, there was something else going on, and that was transmission of an electric current going out. And that always fascinated Carl. Gerard himself said there's something holistic going on, something more than simple connections between neurons. And then Carl worked with Carl Lashley for quite a while, Yerkes lab, and also when Carl was at Yale. And Lashley formulated the laws of mass action. That referred to the findings. Lashley was looking for engrams to see where in the brain do we have these centers of memory, if you will. When in fact he found that even when he taught animals, and usually he worked with rats, he taught them something, and then he would take part of the brain, especially around the hippocampus, remove part of it. But in fact, just taking part of that out did not change the learning. The animal was slower to deal with that learning, but the animal still remembered. And Lashley really wanted to know how this worked, and he influenced Carl Priebram a great deal. Lashley said, it's the pattern. It's the pattern, not the element that counts. Then in the 50s, Wolfgang Köhler and the Gestaltists said, all right, so we have this electric current coming in. And when the electric current, let's say I'm looking at a square box, and the electric current from the radiance of that comes into my eyes, in fact, it forms something square that I see. It's called isomorphism. And that was pushed quite a bit. The electric current was the same as iso, same, morph, shape, as whatever it was coming in from. But in fact, Carl and Roger Sperry and a number of people did disprove that. But after the direct current hypothesis of Köhler, the geometric isomorphism was disproven, it was as if everything shifted, especially since we had the information theory coming in and the paradigm, and we really focused on action potential and only action potential and the EEGs. Quite frankly, we were getting information, but we didn't have the sophistication and we did not have the time, effort, and really the research directed toward that. Now, when Carl spoke, he would often end his talk with dendrites, dendrites, dendrites. If you remember anything, remember dendrites. And they're exquisite part of the brain. As you can see, the dendrites here, we have the axon that goes in one direction, and the dendrites receive messages from other cells. They also interact with themselves. And that is what Carl believed In fact, the dendrites were like little spider webs that would pull in information and process information, even presynaptically. Now, I don't like to read generally, but every word of this Carl was comfortable with, and this is a general idea and a general explanation of Carl and a lot of what he was trying to put across, Carl Priebram. And as we know, the nervous system is made up of neurons. A neuron has a cell body with branches extending from that cell body. And one of the larger branches is chemically different and can support a nerve impulse and a depolarization of its membrane that makes a sharp noise or visual spike. You heard the spikes and saw the, on the electronic equipment to measure it. This level of activity can be thought of as the circuitry of the brain, similar in a way to electricity flowing through a wire. However, according to Priebram, there's a very different process that occurs in the finer branches of the neuron. The area of the telodendrons, we don't use that word very much anymore, but the and dendrites, in a more scientific term, at the distal end of an axon, which it synapses, makes a junction with another neuron, it splits into branches called telodendrons, which connect to the dendrites of another cell. There's a lot going on there. It's non-axon branches through chemical synapses and electrical epitapses. And the telodendrons and dendrites form a dense web of very fine fibers, wavelets, basically, in which processing does not involve nerve impulses, not those wires, not the action potential, but oscillating waves, energy, and other quantum processes, as if this web captures and resonates to and with certain frequencies. Priebram believed that when we become aware, what we become aware of, our conscious experience, may very well be based on what is happening in this processing web. And finally, Priebram took us to a different way of perceiving the mind brain issue, and he always wanted this remembered. Since information cuts across time, space, material, and non-material realms, instead of only considering the Cartesian distinction between matter and non-matter, the duality, we can think of it in terms of the ideal, the potential energy and possibilities around us, superpositions, if you like, and the real, that which we experience, create, and can continue to create from that energy. Now, a lot of people have heard of and connect Carl with the holographic brain, with the hologram. And one of the ways Carl tried to explain to people what he meant by a hologram was by using a slide projector. How many of you remember what a slide projector is? How many of you have one? I'll tell you one university that does not have one, maybe two, right? I had to look a long time at Georgetown about 2 years ago to find a slide projector. It could not be found here, so I cannot show you the actual demonstration, which really is quite compelling and helped a lot of scientists who were confused by what Carl was trying to put across. So please imagine. There's a slide projector. You have a slide in the slide projector. Let's say it's a slide of the brain. And then you project the picture on a screen. Now we take off the lens of the slide projector, or the condenser, if you will. And all you have is a big blur of white light. However, we could show very well that you just take ordinary reading glasses, lenses, and put those lenses anywhere in that white light, and you will, with each lens, you will see a copy of what that slide is, a brain. If you have 50 lenses within that realm of the white light, you will get 50 pictures of the brain, everywhere and every when. And in fact, it's all spread out in a spectral domain, and what you need to take it from that spectral domain is a lens, whether it's the lens of the eye, or you can do this with any of the senses. Our sensory lenses, if you will, that pick up from a larger spectral domain of information the actual picture. And it's all spread, that information, if you want to call it that. And both Carl and Walter had a little bit of problem with the word information because it has people interpreted in so many ways. In fact, when it was used by engineers initially, Claude Shannon himself, Mr. Information, if you will, didn't agree with how it was being used. So it's a matter of semantics, and so many of these words, representation, information, we have a lot of interpretations because we have so many disciplines coming together. But it is if you have a slide projector, go home and try this. Anybody can do it, and it's really amazing. That whole area of white light that was there when you take the lens off, any part of it has the same information that can be brought out, once again, by a lens. One lens, 85 lenses, 1,000 lenses, the same aspect, the same picture. And that is what Carl meant by the hologram. And he talked about wavelets that created interference patterns, and that's what Lashley talked about as well. Now, Walter talks more about fields, the whole field of the wave, larger waves. But all of this information is there and being communicated and changes in many different ways. And at a certain point, some of these wavelets, for example, if they become strong enough, they're local to a certain extent within a certain holonomic area. They become strong enough, they eventually can become part of the action potential, but not necessarily. There's so much information out there it's Wi-Fi again. It's Wi-Fi to a certain extent. I mean, that's a simplistic way of trying to explain it. Now, I direct you, this is from Scholarpedia, and it goes on for several pages, the holonomic brain theory. I urge you to read it because it will talk about Carl. And I did try to extract the underlines. I could not do it. Even our terrific AV guy here could not extract them. So it's just basically, but the idea is once again that there are transformations. And Carl used the Fourier transform as a way of transforming bits of information. Then it's like taking information and then putting it on a spreadsheet, which is the spectral domain. This is very simplistic, but give you an idea, the Fourier transform, and then you can bring it back. So it is reversible, and that's what happens in our brains. When we see something, it goes through the radiance of what we see. It's not a square that comes in electrical form in DC to our brain, as the Gestaltists thought, but it comes in as radiance, and then it is transformed several times in the brain, the occipital lobe, and then going on from there to the cortex, to what we see, to the image. Holonomic brain theory, and I urge you to read more about that. And Carl was very comfortable with what was written about him there. In fact, he wrote a bit about it as well, but I'm just introducing you to that. Now, here is Carl listening to Walter. This is the same day, June 2014. Walter is explaining to Carl, and they're going over what they have appreciated and enjoyed, and the struggle they have found to take back from the neuron doctrine, as Walter calls it. And I urge you, if you did not pick up the handout as you were coming in, do get that. It's Walter's review of Carl's book, The Form Within. They want that rest of the brain information, which is approximately 50% of information we haven't been really bringing in as we talk when we talk about action potential, and which Walter has been pushing for all these years in his field and in brain. Now, in general, Walter's whole approach is called the action perception loop or cycle. And Walter talks about the animal reaching out, that in fact, Thomas Aquinas said it, but intention, that we all have this way of reaching out to the environment, investigating it, searching it. That's the action. And then we bring in information around us, and we also check it out with what we know already with our memory, and eventually we make a decision about what we're going to do, what the next action is. Walter also was very excited about confirming Carl's holonomic theory, because he found, now just recently, Walter was able to use 64 electrodes, an array of 64 electrodes, which is super sophisticated now, within an array, and he would put it in different parts of the olfactory bulb. He usually worked with rabbits. Wherever he put it on the surface of the olfactory bulb, he found he got the same information, the same pattern. And in fact, it was within a certain realm. Remember that white light from the condenser, from the slide projector? Within a certain area, certainly within the surface of the olfactory bulb, the information was distributed. It was the same. It was spatially the same. So little by little, we are continuing to learn so much about the brain, about neurology, about our thinking, about mind and brain. And I liked what Giuseppe said earlier today when asked, well, is it duality? Is it materialism? He said it's unification. How do we bring all of this together now? How do we take the neuron doctrine, especially the action potential, that wiring, that telephone wiring, and how do we also then bring in the Wi-Fi, if you will, and understand how it all works together in terms of our thinking, in terms of our memory, in terms of everything we do, think, and say. Now, most of you have seen an olfactory bulb. I could not find one of a rabbit, but as you can see here, you can see on the dog, it's not that large. However, it is primary, because whether you start out with snails, especially salamanders, the first vertebrate, olfactory was the sense that was primary for a long time, and then it started getting separated into other parts of the brain. And it is still, a lot of what happens in the olfactory bulb can go up to the cortex without going through the thalamus. Most of all, I just want to tell you about these two amazing men who were good friends, who were colleagues since 1950, when Carl was Walter's professor at Yale and has been his mentor and was his professor and good friend for many years. Now, many times they didn't quite, Walter focused on fields, Carl focused on wavelets, but you see at the end it came together even in terms of the holonomic. And Walter and Carl, to have the two of them together. Now, part of that is my photography. They weren't as yellow as they look in this picture, I'm sorry. We were at a pub, and at the same time as the same time, last time they were together, and it meant so much to Carl to have Walter there. We filmed and also did an audio of them talking about their work together. I will tell you, at times when we came to this conference, Carl, we'd go to listen to Walter, and Carl would say, I don't understand a lot of this. So see, even Carl Priebram was human, but he was constantly learning, reaching out, intention, reaching out to learn and bring it back to say, what does this all mean? What do we do next? So I hold both of them in such high esteem, as I'm sure you all do too. Now this is Friday evening. We have had wonderful lectures all day, and certainly my two preceding lecture friends and colleagues. I ask you, when you do leave after the Q&A time, that in fact, you keep Walter and Carl in your minds and continue to do this. Let's all make a toast tonight to Carl Priebram, Walter Freeman, two giants in our fields who absolutely loved coming to this conference. They not only leave us with an extraordinary legacy, but a compelling path to the future. I will say that again, a compelling path to the future. We have to now integrate the Wi-Fi again. We have to integrate all of this to understand how all of it works together. Carl liked to say, don't bite my finger. Look where I'm pointing. So we'll keep looking. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Karen. And I'd like to welcome our other speakers up to the stage, and maybe we could have the lights back on and have questions. And I would just ask the questioners to please speak into the mic, be clear, be concise, ask specific questions so we can maximize engagement. And can we have the lights on, please? Could you turn the lights back on? Thank you. Stuart, I feel you in the darkness. Maybe, okay, there we go.
Oh, this is a second. Thank you, all three. That was great. I can't help a couple of reminiscences. I'm going to cry. They both came to the first conference and have been there many times since. I read Carl's book in Language of the Brain, 1972. I think I read it in 1973. He put forth the holographic theory, and I really liked it. I had already become obsessed with microtubules and Frohlich oscillations. And I read a review of the book that ripped it because they said, look, to make a hologram, you have to shine a laser through a plate and laser interference. Obviously, there are no lasers in the brain. And I wrote to Carl Priebram, whom I didn't know, and I said, I told him about microtubules. I said, they are your lasers. They are the source of your hologram. And we became friends. He invited me to Stanford. And I invited him to the first Tucson conference. He came many times since. And he was great. Walter, I met a little bit later. He was also the first Tucson conference. I remember reading his book, Mass Action in the Nervous System, which was fantastic. And he also emphasized not the firings, not the spikes, but the fields. And I think that's a mistake that people make now. We've heard of this conference of information as spikes. That's not right, I don't think. And those two guys both knew it and emphasized it, but we keep forgetting, because the spikes relate so well to computer analogies, bits, and so forth. So I'll just leave. I do have one question for Tony, though, and that is that if you measure integrated information and complexity and see that it goes down with anesthesia, how is that measure any better or different than a BIS number?
First of all, before I pass this on, they both loved you. And I also want to tell everybody here, when Walter called me to say he had a few days left, I called here immediately and said, help. And Abby and Stuart really rallied. behind what needed to be done and to be set up. And in fact, they even had Skype ready for Walter's best shrift to communicate with him. Unfortunately, Walter was not, had died before then, but I say instead of Skyping, he's in the sky now, so he's still there.
Are you asking how consciousness asking why, goes with the...
Asking why phi is any better as a parameter of consciousness than the bis number, which is, as he knows, in case you don't know, it's an anesthesia monitor we use that goes down as you go to sleep and comes back as you wake up under anesthesia. So why isn't that a theory of consciousness, for example, compared to phi?
Well, obviously, all these measures measure information that are different. Phi is different from the complexity and from the other, but basically it captures the same essence. So the hypothesis that you need integration, information, and it's equivalent to consciousness, this would be consistent with that.
Okay, but we...
That's not your question.
No, I'm just wondering why IIT and phi is any better as an index of consciousness than the BIS number, which we use clinically, even though we don't really know what it is because it's a proprietary algorithm.
Okay, so the phi is, the problem with phi is non-computable because the computational requirement explodes exponentially. I don't doubt the phi maybe superior measure for a small system, but for a large system, you simply cannot calculate it. So it's at that point academic.
Okay, I'm going to move over here to our next question.
Yeah, thank you, great. This is a question for Dr. Busaki. I love Rhythms in the Brain, by the way. Great, dense, rich book. So you talked about how the kick was the impetus for the first organized wave pattern in the brain of an infant. And I'm wondering about a couple of different things. And I'll have to reference another study by Latonin, who discusses the production of 3 to 5 hertz sinusoidal theta when babies between maybe 2 and 6 months are nursing. And so I'm just curious from a developmental and an organizational perspective, what are the networks that are being formed at that point, that initial point, if any? And then what are the structures from which the waveform is coming? And is it sinusoidal? And if so, what would you make of that in terms of the development of the brain?
I think these quantities scale with development exactly as much as well as they scale with the level of consciousness in a setting that I describe. So the quantity would measure from the essentially measuring the richness of experience, that would be lower at a lower development, would be higher at a higher development. And if the same formulation would apply in that case as well.
And Dr. Busaki?
Independent of brain size, independent of species, every single brain develops in a sequential order, or almost sequential order. The first thing is always an output. The brains are there to generate an output. And the next step is to make a sensor that helps that output to make sense of it. When we were first born as animals and we lived in the sea, action, like sponges, allows you to survive. You don't need any sensation. But no amount of sensation will help you to survive without any action. So this is the reason why things go going forward. And this is perhaps a reflection to Karen's note also here. Dendrites, dendrites, dendrites. I want you to remember axons, axons, axons. Because neurons communicate distally with the brain. This is the entire underlying mechanism of mass action that you can reach another neuron far away, and that doesn't happen with the field potential, it happens with action potentials. So the output of a neuron, the output of an organism, no matter how complicated it is the primary thing. And if you think about it, then you will see how complicated things will get if you follow this British empiricist view, Pavlovian view, which is all about inputs to the brain, inputs to the brain, inputs to the brain. They don't care anything about action. an inevitable consequence of all this. We have to find a spooky something up there in order to say, what is a perception? What is watching all these things that are coming out of the world? If you look at the other way around, you start with action, things are simplified.
Please.
Yeah, Dr. Buseki, thanks. So I presume there are genetic algorithms, synaptic.
Can you speak a little bit closer?
Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
So I presume there are genetic algorithms which allow the synaptic homeostasis, which allows the place cells, the head cells and whatnot, to learn predictive coding through activity-dependent synaptic plasticity. So it's learning something complex like memory from something simple like direction. You think something similar to that is happening with other meta-representational processes such as just perception, theory of mind, executive function, where you have these similar genetic algorithms which allow simple perception to do something more complex.
So our brains
come. Is there an analogy there?
Our brains come equipped with a pre-existing dynamic, with a pre-existing wiring. And it's modified a little bit. And your brain is a little bit different from my brain. The number of patterns that you have in the brain are not necessarily different from my brain. Albert Einstein has probably the same number of brain patterns. So what I'd like to, if we have to simplify something, we could say everybody has basically two brains. One is what I call the good enough. The other one is a more precise brain. And we have a couple of papers about this if you're interested, and showing that indeed there's a lot of pre-existing patterns that are useful for something because they are there for you all the time. You come to this room and said, oh, this is a room. This is familiar. Every single thing in the world has elements of familiarity, even for a newborn, because of the pre-existing patterns. So these pre-existing patterns are there, but they are responsible for very small or only part of our actions. So I could say at this moment, 50% of our action potentials in our brain are contributed by only a fraction, let's say 10% of our neurons. And this activity is good enough that I can find my way, I can go around in various parts of the world and have a good enough response to those things that surround me. But in order to make my actions precise 100% of the time, 100 times, that is all the time, we will need the other 50%, which is contributed by very large number of neurons in the brain, and this is where the mass action comes in very handy. So the good enough brain always interacts with the learned patterns. So I can again confront with developments that there is one way of looking at things, that the external world is giving you all that your brain has. The way I view things is a little different. As I say, the pre-existing patterns are there for you. You just have to match some of these patterns with experience. So experience and learning is not making new things in the brain and new patterns in the brain. We just match pre-existing patterns.
So we're just going to have these
I'm not sure if I totally agree with that, because I think that from babies very early on, every bit of action, every bit of learning, there are some pre-existing patterns, and there are some that have to develop developmentally. So actually, we do agree, but I suppose it's the proportion of what genetics, what we're born with, and what then we constantly take in as we learn, as we deal with the world.
I'd like to bring greetings from our society in the UK to this particular session of this conference, because both Carl and Walter were great friends of our society. I'm president of the Scientific and Medical Network in the UK. They used to come across and lecture us and excite us with their science and their new ideas. So I'd like to thank them very much for what they brought, and to thank you all for honoring them.
Thank you. Sir?
So thank you, congratulations. I'm Wagner Legretti with International Academy of Consciousness, and I hope my question is not too much off the topic. But I'd like to know, in your opinion, if spindle neurons, von Economo neurons, and if the glial cells could have some role in production of consciousness as they can process information in a different way.
Can you repeat it again?
Yes. Could von Economo neurons, spindle neurons, and glial cells be part of the production of consciousness because they can process information, it seems, in a different way?
Glial cells, of course, are good partners for neurons. Without glial, there is not much communication. Communication in the brain, let me phrase it again the right way, happens through action potentials. And locally, field potentials can have an impact called effaptic effects. In fact, we have done all the work that exists in vivo that shows that locally you can have an impact. If you go distally, you need to have some kind of level of communication, which is through action potential. Glia can do this trick also because they have gap junctions and the wave can go and travel all around, but that happens at a very slow rate. So if you're interested in cognition at the level of milliseconds, tens of milliseconds, and in this scale, then those solutions are not very useful. They are very useful to set your mood. They are very useful for even bias the activity. They are probably affecting whether your brain is normal or abnormal. But when it comes to communication, the way how mass action happens, how cell assemblies work together, then those are supporting elements. Now, having said that, there are very interesting things. There are many, many people in this room who are interested in stimulating your brain with electrical fields. A good postdoc of mine recently just published a fantastic paper that with small electrical fields, nothing happens to the neurons, but the astrocytes throughout the mouse cortex will be activated. Obviously, this will have a tremendous impact on neural activity. Drugs that affect glia will have a tremendous effect indirectly on neural activity. There is nothing wrong or good about the partners. You just have to see what is the role of one element and what is the role of the other one.
And they are connected, as you remember. And we really can't disconnect them. Now, Walter brings in something that Henry mentioned today, the neurophil. And that is the neuron, but it's also what the neuron is embedded in terms of liquid and in terms of the electrical excitation. And all of this, whether it's glial cells or other parts of the brain, there's something globally that happens at a certain time of excitation. The Hebbian cycle is activated. And one part of the brain is communicating with the other part of the brain, besides what is happening locally.
In regards to the von Economo neurons,
I'm sorry, sir, because technically our time's up, so okay. I just want to get to these other five
Thank
speakers.
You.
So whoever's standing now, these will be the last questioners.
Oh, hi. The Wi-Fi metaphor is so inspiring. So it inspires me to ask this question. I would like to ask our distinguished panelists, are you prepared to entertain idea that is the brain is a display of thought rather than generator of the thoughts, it's a display of thoughts. It's like a computer screen. Would you be prepared to entertain this?
If I get it right, the question is about interaction between the Wi-Fi idea and the action potential.
That's right.
So let me try it this way. Language that we all understand is effective because it's a communication means. Communication means there is an agreement between two parties. That's called coding. Information becomes information. It's not, there is no such a thing as information. It becomes information if it is understood by a receiver, by a observer. So if you look at the variety, the richness of the language, the richness of the language is there because from 30 letters and 40,000 words, we can communicate the entire knowledge of mankind because we have something called syntax. There is a rule in the brain. Now in the brain, syntax is given to you by the multitudes of oscillations the brain generates. This gives you periods, this gives you commas, this gives you separation. Information can be transmitted only if the bits and pieces are segregated enough. The reason why you understand me is because I'm segregating the information what I'm doing now. Now, this waves in the brain or the Wi-Fi gives you a perfect convenient measurement for the observer to say, what's going on? But it's nothing else than the syntax of the brain. You can even decode what language I speak even without understanding it. When I'm talking in Hungarian, you will understand that I'm talking, but you don't understand the content because the content is carried by the action potentials. So adding to the wisdom of Carl Pribram and of course, Walter Freeman, is that this is very important to understand what are the carriers of information, but we also want to know the content. We have to record and analyze all the time both of them, because otherwise we don't understand each other.
Yeah. Could it be that...
I'm sorry.
The context is also very important, besides the context.
Yes. Over here, please.
Thank you. A short story about Carl Pribram, and I'll ask the question. He attended a conference I organized in 1980, and we discussed the high coherence found in certain conditions in the brain. I said to him, does it stand for greater communication between the different parts of the brain? And he said, no, my boy, just greater communion. Now, the only book I brought from India to this conference was Languages of the Brain. I want to congratulate the last speaker and say thank you so much. But in that book, there is a list of the four major processes, of which the last is the inhibition of lateral inhibition. Did he explain clearly how that becomes the means of forming this analogy to the Fourier transform, what I call the general linear transform, across the cortex?
Well, following Languages of the Brain, 1971, he then wrote Brain and Perception, which you haven't, if you haven't read that, continue with that, because he continues with the Fourier transform, and he's really talking about a fast Fourier. He's talking more about the Gabor transform, which is a Fourier is generally infinite. This is a bit of a constrained Fourier. But once again, his book, I urge you all to get his book. It's easy to get online to order, and it's not very expensive. He made it inexpensive, about $25 for about 600 pages of a book of all of this. But it's called The Form Within. And the reason the title is The Form Within, remember the slide projector. Remember all of the spread of information, but then you zero in with our senses, whatever sense it is, to catch the form within.
Sir,
thank you.
Well, as a cognitive psychologist, I thought I would say that there is one additional, very significant contribution.
Could you speak a little bit closer to the microphone?
Well, I was just going to say that as a cognitive psychologist, I think that there is one additional, very significant contribution of Carl Pribram. That's in the Miller, Galanter, and Pribram book. George Miller, Eugene Galanter, Carl Pribram. That appeared in the 1950s and contributed greatly to the cognitive revolution against behaviorism. Not only in emphasizing the computer metaphor, but very significantly in emphasizing brain science and consciousness. Consciousness, what the behaviorists had most fiercely rejected. So I think that's a very significant contribution of Carl Pribram.
You see this as a contradiction?
Yes.
Well, that was in 1960.
Well, I could have had the
Did you say contribution?
I was thinking at the moment, late 50s, it could have been early 60s.
Anyway.
They're close together.
I've taught
a cognitive history course. I know about it.
It's as if he has taken it beyond that, but certainly they focused on feed forward, on tote. And that was significant because it even had to do with plans and connecting the brain with behavior. So it was significant, and it was part of certainly his contribution.
It was also connecting consciousness with, well, all right.
Thank you. My question is for Dr. Buzaki. And I was curious, in the last slide that you kind of went back to, an earlier slide that you showed, had the diagrams of the neural network loops and then how we kind of cross in between as those loops train up and we're able to kind of move between them. I'm hoping that this question even makes sense. I'm kind of new to all this stuff. But would it be fair to say if the training of the neural network loops is more of a parallel process that's kind of going on in the brain, would the ability to jump between them sort of be more akin to like a serial process in our brain, if that makes any sense, if we're comparing like parallel versus serial processing? And also, is that very well understood of how we're able to do that, how we're able to navigate between those neural network trainings that occur?
In complex systems, this term serial and parallel very quickly disappears.
Okay.
The figures we show are extraordinary simplifications. So what I showed you in these loops is basically a good enough brain that I mentioned that is good enough to get around, but in fact that doesn't do anything else, just a little bit of predicting the future. And nobody asked me about creativity. Nobody called me about, asked me about emotions and things like that. Now what happens is that in this basic loop, indeed, you add a lot of complications, but then you add side loops. One such side loop is the hippocampus. Another side loop is the cerebellum. Another side loop is the basal ganglia. So these side loops perform orthogonal information. So if you would like to learn everything about the world, then there are two ways to go. One is that you learn every single thing that happens here, there, somewhere else, now, earlier, and later. That parameter space is just unbelievably large. So what you can do is simplify. So let's take the where, separating them, when, such as the hippocampus, says when things happened. But there is no content. The content is somewhere else, which is in the neocortex. So this is how those simplified pictures should look like. And then you can see that the communication between the different levels and the different loops are done mainly with the help of the amygdala, hippocampus, and others that can cut across the different loops.
Thank you.
And final question, and then I have a few announcements.
This question is for Dr. Buzaki. I'm very interested in this idea of a predictive brain, and I kind of latched on to what you mentioned about, based off of, I assume, some 100 hours of data that you're able to predict with some 95% certainty what path the rat is going to take on a given trial. And I was wondering why you thought, for example, myself, having some thousands of hours of data of myself, am not able to predict what I'm able to do 15 seconds into the future with 95% certainty.
So the simple answer is that rat was in a very simple environment. The choice was between yes or no. It's a binary choice. If you are given a binary choice with your previous knowledge, then in many, many situations, you can make a prediction 5 years ahead. There is no spooky stuff that is needed. If your conviction by about, and your view of light or about everything is about ready by age 20. So if I know you well, I can give you questions and I know your predictions very well and you know it even better. So it is not that this system, simple system that I showed you tells you everything about predictions, but in a simple situation, it is easier. You know, more complicated situations, you need a more complicated hardware, more complicated algorithm, and a longer experience, both phylogenetically as well as in the ontogenetic experience. Smart people do better choices.